Hi, this is Herb Kressel, editor of Radiology. And today I'm joined by Dr. Jerry Jarvik, a neuroradiologist and professor of radiology, neurosurgery, and health services at the University of Washington. Jerry also directs the Comparative Effectiveness, Cost, and Outcomes Research Center at the University of Washington. Dr. Jarvik and his colleagues have authored a really interesting and provocative study on lumbar imaging and reporting epidemiologic data, and does this additional data affect subsequent clinical management? And joining us and moderating this session is my colleague and friend, the deputy editor for neuroradiology in our journal, Professor David Kallmes of the Mayo Clinic. David?
Thanks, Herb. Before we get started talking about Jerry's paper in detail, I want to say that we receive a lot of great papers at Radiology, and we're very fortunate to receive them. I have to say, this paper really caught my attention when I read it. I thought, you know, this is something we need to publish. It's innovative, it's new, and it has impact. So with that, could you tell us in a few words what you did and what you found?
Sure. And I also want to say thank you to both Herb and Dave for having me on this podcast. It's actually very exciting to be able to talk about our work. In a nutshell, what we did was we added a brief statement containing some epidemiological data about findings in patients without low back pain on MRI, so lumbar spine MR findings in asymptomatic patients, in order to put into a context the many findings that you can see in patients that do have back pain. So for example, the statement contained the prevalence of disc bulges and annular fissures and those sorts of things, which may or may not have anything to do with somebody's pain. That in a nutshell is what we did. Now, we had a natural experiment that we took advantage of. We started adding this statement back around 2005. And this was all because of actually an article that was published in The Lancet years before by two very prominent back pain researchers, Sir Martin Rowland and Van Tulder. And they recommended adding this epidemiological data to the routine interpretation of radiographs of the lumbar spine. And when we first looked at it, we thought, gee, that's a good idea. Why aren't we doing this routinely? And you know, that was in the late 90s. It took until about 2005 to actually get around to implementing that. We started doing it in 2005, and when I say we, out of about a dozen neuroradiologists, there were two of us that actually used it on a routine basis, myself and Quinn Nguyen. And we just went along doing this for a number of years until a colleague of mine, Brooke Martin, said, gee, you know, you've got data here that you could actually look at retrospectively and see what impact this may have had, because not everybody was getting this statement. And while it wasn't randomized who did and who didn't get the statement, it was pretty arbitrary.
And random.
Pretty arbitrary. Uh-huh. Not random. Mm. Not everything in the world has to be randomized. and so that we did. We went back, we looked retrospectively at who did, who did not get this statement, and what happened to them subsequently. Our a priori hypotheses were that patients that got the statement would end up having more reassurance, both the physicians treating them as well as the patients, and get fewer subsequent interventions, which would include subsequent cross-sectional imaging, maybe subsequent physical therapy, and maybe narcotic use. And so we looked at all of these things to see what actually happened to the people that didn't get the statement.
Now, Jerry, was the statement targeted to the findings, or was it a general statement about the epidemiology of potential findings?
So it was a general statement. Although that actually brings up a good point, is one thing that we might be able to do with this in the future would be to tailor it actually to the individual patient. But no, it was a general statement about just stating what the prevalence was of various findings in a symptomatic population.
Well, the other thought that occurs to me is, why not have that statement at the point of order entry as opposed to the point of the examination?
so that it might dissuade people from actually getting the imaging study in the first place? I think that's an interesting idea. You could potentially do that as part of
Decision support.
Absolutely, computerized decision support system that would have this prevalence built into it.
To clarify, in your study, you focused exclusively on primary care physicians and family physicians to exclude the potentially more knowledgeable spine surgeons, neurosurgeons, and so forth.
Yeah,
Is that correct?
That's right. That's right. And when we went through retrospectively and looked at all the patients that had lumbar spine MRs over this 2.5 year period, we found that a relatively small proportion was coming from primary care docs. Most of our referrals came from orthopedic surgeons and physiatrists and people who were well acquainted with what the prevalence was of these findings in asymptomatics and actually probably had a focused reason for getting the MR other than to work up the garden variety low back pain. And it was the uncomplicated low back pain patients from the primary care that we wanted to focus on because that's where we thought we would likely have the greatest influence. Those referrers probably had were less familiar with the epidemiologic data that we were adding. Mm-hmm.
And also to clarify, of the several outcomes you looked at, further imaging, intervention, surgery, it was the difference in proportion of patients prescribed narcotics that reached statistical significance in this study.
It was. That was the only one that we found that was statistically significant, although the magnitude of the effect was what really surprised us. It was about three and a half times less in those that got the statement compared to those that didn't. The subsequent imaging, I think that was on the order of about 4.5 times maybe, and physical therapy was twice as much in those that got the statement. But those weren't statistically significant. Our sample size was relatively small for this sort of retrospective study. We ended up with around 70 to 80 patients in the statement group and a little bit more than double that in the non-statement group. We probably need several fold that number in order to look at the many different outcomes that we're potentially interested in that this statement might have an impact
on. So that begs the question, how do you do a prospective study when you're essentially doing research on referring physicians?
Well, I think that we're doing research on both the physicians and the patients. They're both downstream of this radiologic or epidemiologic information that we're adding. It's true for any study of a diagnostic test that most of the impact that you're going to measure, unless you're in a screening situation, is going to be via a physician for the most part. But that doesn't mean that there aren't direct effects on the patients, and especially in this day and age when more and more patients are seeing directly the imaging reports, that you can have a direct influence on what they think about their disease, mm-hmm. how much they worry about certain findings. The way that we word things is actually quite important, and there are a number of efforts now to get the imaging reports directly into the patient's hands quickly. Actually, I was just at a session this morning, which was a Radlec session on structured reporting, where one of the speakers, Marta Heilbrunn, who's at the University of Utah, say that they have a policy now where they want that report accessible to patients within 3 days of it being finalized. And there are other institutions that are going along the same lines. So
really the audience for this study is not just physicians, not just patients. What other groups do you want to target with this line of research?
Well, I think it's anybody that has access to the imaging report, of which physicians and patients are probably the most important, but payers and insurers will certainly have access to this information as well, and probably could stand to be educated as well as the patients as to what the importance of various findings are. Mm-hmm. So, I think that as long as there's a strong evidence basis behind the information that we're putting into the report, there's no reason not to have it accessible.
Right. And I think stepping back from this paper in isolation, we're often, as radiologists, challenged to do meaningful research in patient outcomes. Mm-hmm. Many diagnostic radiologists lament the fact that there are barriers between their intervention and the final patient outcome. But this is a study that shows that that's not true, that a diagnostic radiologist can have direct impact on patient outcome. And I think it's an important teaching paper for people interested in any type of radiology research.
Yeah, there's actually been a term coined for that direct effect of the diagnostic test. It's in the context, actually, it was a coined term by Hal Sachs, who did a study at Stanford quite a number of years ago, where he randomized patients who were having chest pain, coming into the emergency room with chest pain, to either getting an EKG and enzymes or no diagnostic testing. And these were people who had clearly non-cardiac chest pain, so normally they wouldn't be getting the testing. And so they got the testing, and invariably the test results were that they weren't having a heart attack. And what he did was he measured before and after the diagnostic testing various measures of health-related quality of life, and what he found was those that got the tests did better than those that didn't get the tests. And he, I think, attributed this to a reassurance value of the test and called this the therapeutic value of the diagnostic test. And so that's one side of the coin where a diagnostic test can reassure people. The other side of the coin is that if you're in a condition where incidental findings are common and people would tend to worry about them, then you can actually cause people to worry more by simply having the diagnostic test. So what we're trying to do by inserting this information is to mitigate that worrying.
It's very interesting. I think one of the things that I was struck with when we first were discussing this paper was, you know, there's a lot of concern about the report itself and the structure, the terms that are used, but to actually consider that the report itself can affect the patient outcome, what's in it and what's not in it, is really an amazing thought, because I think you really, this is a whole new way to look at things. All the care that we put into what is in the report to have more information about the effect that it will have on outcome and management, I think is a really fine contribution.
Well, thank you. I actually think that it's sort of an untapped resource that we have with the report. And in talking to some of the Radlex people, they've done, I think, a very nice job in their structured reporting of identifying the key components of the report. You know, I would advocate adding an additional section, which is epidemiologic information, which can help put into context finding. And, you know, I think low back pain is one example where it works well because there's a high rate of incidental findings, but you know, you could imagine expanding it to all sorts of scenarios.
Absolutely. Do you see any risk, though, in terms of the way that our referring clinical colleagues view issues of domain? Are we acting too much as the clinician and not just as a diagnostician?
So, I mean, it's an interesting point. When we first started doing this, people were very concerned that we would turn off the referring clinicians, that essentially their referrals would drop for procedures, or I'm not even sure what they were concerned about, that that maybe we were overstepping the line. That actually wasn't the case at all. We weren't, when we started inserting this into the reports, we didn't discriminate at all as to which physicians got this. So the experienced physiatrist got this, as well as the primary care doc that had never ordered an MR in their life before. Everybody got the same template, the same macro that was inserted into the report. For the most part, the experienced orthopedic surgeons and the physiatrists loved this insert because what it did was it cut down on the amount of time that they had to spend sitting with a patient, you know, explaining to them that their black disc really wasn't something they had to worry so much about.
Right.
And the primary care docs actually appreciated the information because it was information they might not have known about
right.
In advance. So Now, maybe it's just because people don't want to come to my face and tell me you're such an idiot, why did you put this in? But we haven't gotten any negative feedback in the years now that we've been doing this on a routine basis.
And is this now routine for you? Do you do it in every...
It is. So part of the barrier to implementing this on a regular basis was technological. And it wasn't until we had a reporting system that could easily incorporate macros, and then a reporting system that we could assign a site macro so that it was the default for everybody to incorporate, that pretty much everybody in our system now includes it in their report.
Oh, wow.
So yeah, we are doing it routinely, and a number of the different systems in Seattle are doing it routinely as also. I understand at Virginia Mason, where a colleague went, Craig Blackmore, and he has convinced his radiologist to start incorporating it. So,
all right.
Slowly but surely, it's creeping out there.
Is there anything else you'd like to add about the study that we haven't touched upon?
Well, I mean, one of the questions that you started to ask was, you know, where to go at this point, and how do you study this if your primary subject are physicians rather than patients, although I would say it's both. And what I would like to see, what I would like to do is actually a randomized trial. As I mentioned earlier, this wasn't randomized, and there is the potential for bias having crept in that we aren't, of which we're not aware. By actually randomizing either physicians, or what we really thought about is randomizing clinics, because you have this possibility of contaminating one physician who, I mean, if you one physician works side by side with another physician who's getting the reports, you can avoid that contamination by randomizing clinics, prospectively randomizing clinics, and actually seeing how their practice changes downstream, and looking at some of the things that we got a hint of a signal of, which is physical therapy and subsequent cross-sectional imaging, but also, most importantly, looking at narcotic use, because opiate use is, you know, I think, and this is to paraphrase Rick Dio, who is a, you know, sort of the dean of back pain researchers, it really is probably the most important topic in low back pain research that's going to surface in the next several years. There's a real epidemic of opiate use, especially in the elderly, and adverse effects that can result from that are quite serious potentially. And so if you have an intervention which can decrease that, and an intervention which is easy to implement and inexpensive and has few deleterious side effects, then that's hopeful. So that's where we hope to go.
Well, Jerry, I want to really thank you on behalf of myself and David for a very stimulating discussion of a really fascinating manuscript. Thanks so much for coming by.
Well, thank you. Can I mention one more thing, which is the first author on this manuscript, Brendan McCullough, is a resident at our place, and you know, he did a yeoman's job of actually putting together the data, writing the manuscript, and really deserves a lion's share of the credit for this. So thank you, Brendan.